All right, today we'll finish up on physiological effects and complications of positive pressure ventilation. And I don't know what page it is on your handout. Page 7 on mine? Page 5. So we'll start off by talking about different types of barotrauma that occur in the lungs. So when you're putting a patient on positive pressure ventilation, it's possible that the air can leak somewhere, whether an alveolus ruptures, and now the air is getting from the alveolar sac into the interstitial space. A big enough hole is going to allow air to get from inside the lung across into the pleural space, and then air can start leaking into the pleural space. It can also migrate around the heart and get into the pericardial sac. So all this can happen because of positive pressure ventilation. And there's lots of notes coming up on it. So first one is pneumothorax. So when there's rupture of the lung parenchyma, air will migrate through the ruptured area and accumulate in the pleural space surrounding the lung. And this will further compress the lung. So once that hole is developed, air will keep leaking breath after breath and just start accumulating in the pleural space. And every little bit of air starts pressing externally on the lung. So the increased pressure shifts the lung and the mediastinal pressures to the opposite side. As the tension builds, breath sounds become diminished and with time will become absent. And this positive pressure will be felt by the heart, and a lot of pressure will actually prevent blood from getting into the heart and being ejected out of the heart, so cardiac arrest can ensue. And then for treatment, it leaves it blank. What is a treatment for a pneumothorax? A chest tube. Okay, and then where is it placed? Fourth intercostal space? Laterally, anteriorly?
Laterally.
Laterally? Are you guys thinking about a pleural effusion and where you would drain the pleural effusion?
Oh, sorry.
Okay. So fluid will go down, but air will go up. So when you're putting a chest tube in for a pneumothorax, it's between the second and third ribs, and it's placed anteriorly. So air goes up, fluid goes down. That makes a difference in where you put your chest tube. And I want you to write this question. What are the signs of a pneumothorax? What are the signs of a pneumothorax? On a patient with PPV, and PPV stands for positive pressure ventilation. So what are the signs of a pneumothorax on a patient on positive pressure ventilation? Do you know the answer to this already?
Low blood pressure.
Low blood pressure? Okay. So you've got the positive pressure in the pleural space pushing on all the vessels, and now you've got less blood flowing to the heart. Okay, so low blood pressure. Robert?
Unilateral chest rise.
Unilateral chest rise. So air is accumulating in the pleural space, squeezing that lung, and now that lung no longer inflates. But the lung that's not affected inflates and deflates perfectly. Yes, so unilateral chest rise.
The return tidal volume?
Okay, so the return tidal volume would be decreased because instead of the air coming back to the ventilator, it's going into the pleural space.
Decrease in delta
P. A decrease in delta P? When the lung is compressed, you would have higher pressure. So it would take more pressure to try to push the air into that lung that's being compressed. So you'd have higher pressure and a higher plateau pressure. that would be in volume modes and in PRVC that would happen. So the ventilator is trying to ventilate this lung, but this lung is being compressed. So now it's going to try harder and harder to push the air into this lung, and you'll notice higher airway pressures. So increased airway pressures, if you do a plateau hold, plateau pressure, that's going to be elevated. What about pressure control though? Same thing? Will pressures keep going higher and higher in pressure control? Yeah, we're setting a limit in pressure control, so how would we know that we're not ventilating that one lung?
The volume.
Yeah, so smaller tidal volume we turn, and pressure control. Arrow down VT, so lower tidal volume, and pressure control. And then you go to listen to breath sounds, which you expect to
diminish.
So breath sounds are diminished, and then eventually the lung is so compressed you hear nothing. So it depends on the progression. If it just happened, you're still going to hear some breath sounds, but over several minutes, air keeps leaking into the pleural space, and then eventually you hear no breath sounds. Would you expect the trachea and the mediastinal structures to shift if you've got a lot of pressure on one side?
Yes.
So tracheal shift away from the side with the pneumothorax. All right, once you have air escaping somehow and getting into the pleural space, the air might just stay in the pleural space, but then it also might migrate into the subcutaneous tissue. And you can actually feel it, depending on how severe it gets. You can be palpating anywhere on the chest and feel air like bubbling under the skin. And when you press on it, it almost feels like spongy and like compared to Rice Krispie cereal,
yeah.
Like you hear the yeah. All right, so if you feel subcutaneous emphysema when you're palpating the skin, it wants to know what the cause of this is. So it wants you to fill in reasons why you would have subcutaneous emphysema. So the reason we just talked about, which is what?
Pneumothorax.
So put that down. When the patient gets a tracheostomy, where the incision is, now you've got skin separated from the supporting tissue underneath, and air can just get from the atmosphere in between that tissue. So tracheal incision. Air can enter into the space between the skin and the supporting structures. Another place to write down is a chest tube incision. So when the skin and the tissues underneath the skin are cut, in order for the chest tube to be placed into the pleural space, now you are exposing that to the atmosphere. And air can get from the atmosphere in between the layers of the skin, and you'll feel subcutaneous emphysema around the chest tube incision. So you can just summarize by writing any place there is a break in the skin, subcutaneous emphysema can develop. So any place there is a break in the skin, sub-Q emphysema. All right, so when we put a patient on a ventilator and we're using positive pressure ventilation to ventilate, we can cause injury to the lungs. And it can be caused at the level of the sinus. So the alveolar ducts, the alveoli, can be affected by this positive pressure. It's due to over-distension of the alveoli. So when there's too much volume being pushed into the alveoli, that's when we can cause an injury to occur at the alveolar level. When you've damaged the alveoli have inflammatory mediators that get released into the tissue. You've got fluid going into the alveoli, and all of that makes the lungs stiff. So the patient may have not started out with stiff lungs, but now that we've been ventilating and damaging them with the tidal volume that we're pushing in, now they can have a ventilator associated injury or ventilator induced lung injury. Where do we write down? Oh, here we go. This kind of explains it. So it's already in your notes. It says some areas of the lung are more compliant than others, and more volume will go to the compliant areas. The resulting over-distension to these areas causes acute lung injury. So even when we're calculating the ideal body weight and we're setting the tidal volume to be 6 to 8 mL per kilogram ideal body weight, it's possible that there's stiff areas of the lungs that aren't getting much ventilation at all, but the compliant areas of the lung are getting all of that tidal volume. So even though we're trying to be careful, we can still cause injury because there's different compliances in the lung. So we pretty much ruin the good alveoli because they have a nice compliance, and then when you push the air in, they can accept the air, they accept a lot of air, and that's when the alveolus becomes overstretched and gets little tiny tears in it, and that's where the damage occurs. So the over-distension tells you that you'll get edema. So edema will occur in the alveoli. There will be increased permeability of the capillaries. So the capillaries start leaking fluid into those areas. The fluid is going to alter the surfactant function. So we know the alveolus has this soapy film of surfactant in it. But once you get edema coming in from the capillaries, kind of washes out and changes the surfactant's ability to keep the alveolus open. The other thing that happens is there is a release of inflammatory mediators. So it starts a cascade of, hey, we've got a problem, body, there's some damage occurring here, and now the body is heightened, knows that there's damage occurring, and it'll cause this pathway of inflammation to occur. Another sentence to add to that. There is a release of inflammatory mediators. There is a release of inflammatory mediators. Called cytokines. There's several. I'm mentioning one that's very common. Cytokines are spelled C-Y-T-O-K-I-N-E-S, cytokines. So, did you get that, cytokines? And then this leads to multi-organ failure. This leads to multi-organ failure. So we damage the alveoli, we get some edema, the capillaries become permeable, we get these inflammatory mediators being released, and now the message to the rest of the body is, you know, we've got problems. And then the body releases cytokines throughout. It doesn't just limit it to the lungs. So you'll notice that there's a cascade of events. You know, first the lung is damaged, and then the next thing you know, the other organs in the body are damaged. So multi-organ failure.
things in the cytokines cause inflammation?
Cytokines, yes. The injury at the alveolar capillary level, it talks about the uneven expansion and collapse of lung units during positive pressure ventilation can cause another potential injury problem called shear stress or atelectasis trauma. This is when alveoli expand during inspiration and then they collapse during exhalation. And then the next breath is delivered from the ventilator and it pushes the alveolus open, and then on exhalation the alveolus collapses again. So that's shear stress, I guess, shearing it open or pushing it open, and then it collapses again. Push it open and then it collapses again. Now we've damaged the alveolus. If we use PEEP and keep those alveoli open, now we're preventing that from happening. So using optimal PEEP will prevent atelectasis trauma or shear stress from occurring. This is a video that's showing the alveoli expanding and collapsing.
I think you had a fresh plate of them.
This is in slow mode or something? Or is Yvonne in just fast mode?
Microscope utilized to view alveoli in vivo is a dark field heavy objective metallurgy microscope. A suction head was constructed to secure the lung surface to a cover slip with light vacuum. This allows us to film the same alveoli throughout tidal ventilation. The suction head can be moved in both the X and Y direction to scan the lung surface under the cover slip. The microscope image is filmed with a digital camera and recorded on a Super VHS system. The videotape is digitized and the digital image analyzed by computer image analysis for changes in
the size. That's like an old computer, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yes. Seen here are subpleural pulmonary alveoli in the living pig during standard mechanical ventilation. Alveoli appear as distinct sphere-shaped objects with extra alveolar blood vessels separating individual alveoli. Alveoli are in sharp focus at expiration and go out of focus during inspiration. Capillaries can be seen traversing over the alveoli. Note that normal alveoli do not change size appreciably during tidal ventilation. Also note that capillary perfusion across alveoli stops at peak inspiration. This is visualization of classic West Zone 2 capillary perfusion. These are alveoli following acute lung injury by tween instillation. Tween is known to deactivate pulmonary surfactant and is utilized as a model for the adult respiratory distress syndrome, or ARDS. In stark contrast to normal alveoli, alveoli in the acutely injured lung change size dramatically with tidal ventilation. We can see two distinct types of abnormal alveolar mechanics. In the upper center of the field, note an alveolus which totally collapses and expands with each tidal ventilation.
I see a few of them.
Several
I see like one here.
Change size
this one collapses.
But do not totally collapse at end expiration. We have categorized alveoli which collapse totally at expiration as type 3, and those which change size significantly but do not totally collapse as type 2. In this scene, we are located near the edge of the lung lobe, which is the dark border at the right edge of the screen, such that alveoli have more area to expand. Note the large change in alveolar size with tidal volume.
Yeah, they get huge. Look at this
alveoli one. Do not totally collapse, and thus they're classified as type 2 alveoli. This scene depicts normal alveoli as the lung is slowly inflated with a super syringe. This maneuver is used clinically to generate a whole lung pressure volume curve and as a recruitment maneuver to inflate alveoli. It is currently believed by many that in the injured lung that all alveoli recruit at a similar pressure, which is identified on the pressure volume curve as an inflection point or P flex. We will demonstrate in subsequent footage that this is not true. The lung, seen here, was being slowly inflated in 20 milliliter increments by the super syringe during this entire narration. Please note that these normal alveoli did not change size appreciably throughout this recruitment maneuver. Here we will see the effect of a similar recruitment maneuver in the lung injured by twin lavage. All alveoli in this area of lung are totally collapsed so that no distinct alveoli can be seen. Note that as the lung is inflated, alveoli begin to pop open and recruit. Alveoli will continue to recruit throughout the inflation cycle. Once open, alveoli do not increase greatly in size. We see here a large alveolus recruiting in the upper left portion of the field.
Oh, there it is. I wonder if anything's going to happen over here.
And again, another large alveolus recruiting in the upper right part of the field. The lung is now being slowly deflated, and alveoli can be seen to systematically deflate throughout the deflation cycle. Note that alveoli did not all recruit at a single point, which indicates the P flex seen on the whole lung pressure volume curve is not the result of massive alveolar recruitment. In summary, with this in vivo microscopic technique, we can visualize and quantify alveolar mechanics in the living animal. This allows us to assess the impact of various ventilatory strategies, such as low tidal volume, PEEP, the open lung approach, or a recruitment maneuver at the alveolar level. We postulate that these data will allow us to choose the optimal ventilatory strategy, which will decrease the morbidity and mortality associated with ventilator-induced lung injury.
Okay. What did that show?
Sheer stress.
Sheer stress, okay. So you see that damaged lungs, the alveoli collapse. Mm-hmm. Do you know why the alveoli collapse?
Has a lot of trauma.
Yeah, so they treated that lung, the pig lung, with something that caused ARDS in the alveoli. So it basically washed out the surfactant, and now the alveoli have nothing to help keep them open and they collapse. Then they started increasing pressure, and the alveoli started opening at different times. Some took a little pressure to open, some needed a lot of pressure before they came open. So looking for optimal PEEP to keep the alveoli open. Once all of those alveoli open up, now you're going to have better oxygenation. So that's what we see at the bedside. We have a 5 of PEEP, and you know our SATs are low. What can we do to improve SATs? You increase PEEP. And 7, the SATs are still low. You increase PEEP some more. And what's happening is those collapsed alveoli are starting to pop open. And then when you get to whatever it takes for most of those alveoli to be open, now you're going to notice your saturation is better. That's how that relates to what we see on the bedside. And it's amazing to see how lack of surfactant is going to affect whether the alveoli stay open. All right, and then oxygen toxicity. High FiO2s do cause damage to the alveolar epithelium. And it's noticeable within 6 hours of breathing pure oxygen. Within 24 hours, there's several events that can happen that damage the lungs. we don't want to keep somebody on 100%. That might be initially during an emergency we're using 100%, but our goal is to wean the FiO2 until our SATs are at an acceptable level, but to try to get them off those high concentrations of oxygen. And what helps a lot is PEEP. Quiz questions. A decreased cardiac output when a patient is placed on mechanical ventilation is caused by A, B, or C. Positive pressure increases resistance of pulmonary blood flow. So you have positive pressure in the chest. Does it put a squeeze on the pulmonary vessels and cause decreased cardiac output? Okay. B, positive intrathoracic pressure decreases venous return to the heart. Yeah, when you have a lot of positive pressure in the chest, the blood flow back to the heart has been compromised. So you'll notice a lower blood pressure, meaning that you have a lower cardiac output. So it's both A and B. Does keeping cuff pressure between 20 and 25 centimeters of water prevent aspiration of oropharyngeal secretions? The answer A, yes, completely. B, nope, not a chance. Or C, it helps but doesn't completely eliminate aspiration of secretions. Yes, the correct response is C. So we might think, okay, we've got the endotube in the trachea, we've inflated the cuff, and now that cuff is touching the tracheal wall, nothing's going to get past it and into the lungs, and the lungs will be protected because of that cuff. And that's actually a misnomer. It doesn't happen that way. You still get aspiration of some oropharyngeal secretions dripping down past the cuff and into the lungs. Loss of surfactant from repeated opening and closing of the alveoli is called A, atelectasis trauma, B, ventilator-associated pneumonia, or C, pneumomediastinum.
A.
A, atelectasis trauma. Positive pressure ventilation in a patient causes the release of inflammatory mediators such as cytokines, and this leads to multi-system failure. It's false? Well, give me some thoughts. Why do you think it's false?
We give positive pressure ventilation all the time, or not if somebody has inflammatory mediators?
That
would be if the alveoli itself
are damaged.
If the lung is injured, then it
will
release when it
doesn't
into the lung, so it
releases
all the body.
So this doesn't necessarily
if it causes
the
volume.
Yeah,
I don't think.
Is it damaged?
I think that the lungs would have to be damaged in order for there to be an influx of cytokines in the lungs.
Okay. So you're saying it's false because not all positive pressure ventilation will cause this cascade of events. That's why you're selecting false. What about, go ahead.
I think that there's not enough information to tell.
She wants a paragraph.
What information would you add to make it true?
I mean, positive pressure can lead to it if they're on it long enough, but I guess because it's not saying if the lungs are already damaged or not.
Oh. Can this occur?
Yes.
Can positive pressure cause damage to the alveoli?
So,
and when it causes damage, will cytokines be released?
Yes.
And not only do those cytokines stay in the lungs, do they travel and affect other organs?
Yes.
So, maybe if the word can cause the release of inflammatory mediators, would you have selected
yes.
true?
Yes.
Yeah?
Because it's saying that what I'm reading is it says positive pressure ventilation the patient causes. So every time a patient is put on positive pressure, this will happen. That's what I understood from it.
I see. So it was just too general for you to
yeah.
say that it's true.
That's why I said I wish you explained it because it was very general.
I see. Yeah. All right. So yes, this does happen with positive pressure ventilation. Does it happen with any amounts of positive pressure ventilation? No, I'm sure small amounts are not going to cause that. But larger amounts of pressure in the lungs do cause it. Which is why we try to limit our airway pressures, because that's a reflection of our alveolar pressures.
That's true.
Yes. Volute trauma cannot happen if a patient is ventilated with tidal volumes of 6 to 8 mLs per kilogram. So it cannot happen is false because we can use the best tidal volume for the patient, and there can be areas that are more compliant than others, and those compliant areas will receive more of that tidal volume. And it can still cause damage. So even with normal tidal volumes, volute trauma can occur. So you put false for that?
Mm-hmm.
Which of the following lead to ventilator-associated pneumonia? Select one or more. A, the presence of an endotracheal tube for more than 48 hours. Yes. So with the epiglottis being held open and the endotube in there, all of the contamination or just normal secretions. So when I say contamination, oral pharyngeal secretions have bacteria, and that's normal. And when those secretions get into the trachea and into the lungs, that's not normal. So now the bacteria can thrive, and that's where a pneumonia can develop. So yes, anytime a patient is intubated and placed on a ventilator, they're at risk for developing pneumonia. And that's why we're so diligent with mouth care. We're trying to prevent the bacteria from growing in the mouth and oral pharynx and dripping down into the lungs and causing pneumonia. So we're going to select A. Gastric reflux